remember that day very well. I'd been fishing way out past the reef since 4 that morning, when I finally headed back to shore. It was a good catch, and I was already thinking of all the money I'd been getting from the fish market. I had never tried selling fish to the fish market before, but I knew I had caught plenty of good ones. I remember thinking how happy my wife and little children would be when I came home. "Daddy," they'd say, "Daddy, so much money, Daddy, where did you get it?" And there were plenty of things we had been needing. Anyway, I'd heard this fish market paid really well for good fish. They were supposed to only buy the best. So I knew that from now on, this was the place to sell my fish. The fish market supervisor followed me out of the boat to see the big catch I just told him about. And I'm not shy, you know, when it comes to telling people what a good fishman I am. Even though I had never sold fish to this market before, everyone around here knows that I can really fish. But I guess I was a bit too eager to load my fish into the fish box. And I wasn't too careful about where the fish ended up. But I sure wasn't ready for the market supervisor's reaction. He just shook his head. He wouldn't even tell me why he wouldn't buy my fish.
Oh, no, you must come tell me, sir. Hard work here, man.
All he said was, "Go see the fisheries department." Bloody bugger. A few days later, I did visit the fisheries department. I knew a fellow who worked there, so I tried to find him. I had been fishing all my life, you see, but there must be something wrong if this fish market wouldn't buy my fish. I told the fisheries extension officer what had happened at the market. I asked him why the market wouldn't take my fish. "I'm a fisherman," I told him. "I have to sell my fish." The extension officer asked me how I usually fish and what I do with the fish after I pull them in. So I told him, "Oh, when I'm out there fishing, I just want to catch as many fish as I can. And as soon as I hook one, I pull them in, I throw them onto the boat and get my line back in the water as fast as I can." He asked me, "Do you use a fish box or an insulated container?" "No," I told him. "The fish just lie on the bottom of my boat. But they're all right. Nothing can happen to them there, can it?" He asked me if I put my fish into a hold, or at least keep them out of the sun. "No, I mean they're in the sun," I told him. "But why should that make any difference?" "And your cutting board," he asked me, "where you gut and gill the fish, do you keep that clean?" "Oh, yes, I clean that," I told him. "I think I cleaned it just a couple of weeks ago." "Oh, I think I understand your problem," the extension officer told me. But he wanted to see my boat first. "And now my boat, man, is my pride and joy, you know. I worked very hard before I could buy that boat. But when the extension officer saw it, he didn't seem very impressed." "There's one of your problems," he told me. He said my boat was filthy. Not only did I have things all over the place, but he pointed out the dirt and pieces of fish bait rotting inside my boat. He pointed out how it was attracting flies. "And just look at your fish box," he said. I had to admit, my fish box was not in a very good shape. In fact, I had never even used it to store fish since I got it. I just didn't see the point. In the old days, we never had such things. I asked the extension officer, why is all this so important? He told me that the fish market needs fresh fish of the best quality because some of their fish is exported overseas. And that meant that conditions in my boat would have to be just as high a standard to help prevent the fish I catch from spoiling or becoming contaminated. And so, I had to start keeping my boat really clean. Follow me, he said, and I'll show you something else. The extension officer took out two fish from a fish box. The first one, he showed me, would never be accepted by the fish market, he told me. The flesh was soft, and the bright red color of the fish had faded. The eyes were sunken and dull. He then pointed out that the blood inside the fish had turned brown. It hadn't been cleaned properly, he told me, and it probably came from a dirty boat like mine. So the fish had gone bad, and the fish market refused to buy it. The other fish was one which would be accepted by the fish market. He said it was still very fresh and red because it had been chilled properly. The flesh was firm, and the eyes were full and shiny. This fish had been cleaned properly, he told me. All the blood had been cleaned out. The reason this fish was so different from the other one is simply because it was chilled properly right after it was caught. The other fish had gone stale because of bad handling and because it had been left in the sun. Mind you, he said, some markets require whole fish. Therefore, find out from the local market what they want and supply fish not gutted and gilled if they demand it. The extension officer also told me how to chill fish properly. He said I would have to use good, clean ice. There were different forms of ice I could use, but the most common were block ice, crushed block ice and cheap ice. Block ice usually comes in big blocks, he said. And it lasts longer than cheap ice because it doesn't melt as quickly. He showed me what crushed block ice looked like too. I should be careful though, he told me, because if the crushed block ice is not broken up small enough, the ice can have sharp edges which can damage the fish. Cheap ice or flake ice comes like this, he explained. They are very small pieces which pack easily around the fish. The extension officer showed me two different ways I could chill fish on my boat. The quickest and easiest way was to make a seawater ice slurry. The second way was to pack the fish with crushed or chip ice. The extension officer told me that to make a seawater ice slurry, two buckets of crushed or chip ice had to be mixed with every bucket of seawater. He showed me by pouring two buckets of seawater into a fish box that had already had four buckets of ice. The slurry is good, he said, because the fish can be taken off the hook and put straight into the slurry to start chilling right away. Imagine, he said, even if the fish is still alive, the shock of the cold water will just knock them right out. He said an ice slurry is good too because it surrounds the fish completely and the cold moves into the fish very quickly. Fish should not be kept in a slurry for longer than 6 to 8 hours, he told me. Otherwise, the fish will lose its color and the eyes will start to go white because of the salt in the seawater slurry. And that might lower the price I get for my fish at the market. So after 8 hours, he said, I'd have to either pack the fish in ice or come back in to shore. To pack my fish with crushed or chip ice, he told me, a good layer of ice should be placed in the box followed by a layer of fish. After all my fish are put in, I should pack a layer of ice on top of the fish, completely surrounding the fish in ice. If I only cover the top of the fish with ice and leave the bottom without ice, he told me that only the parts of the fish next to the ice will be chilled. If I use crushed block ice which has too many large pieces, he told me, it could leave air gaps around the fish which might keep it from chilling properly. And the sharp edges of the ice could damage my fish. He then showed me the right way to gut and gill the fish when this is required. A lot of fishermen forget to clean out the bloodline, he told me. But this is very important. Then he showed me how to clean the inside of the fish with water and a scrubbing brush. By getting all the blood cleaned out, he said it helps preserve the fish longer. And if I clean the outside of the fish, I'll take off the slime from the surface and help make it look better for sale at the fish market. The extension officer then told me that handling fish gently after it is caught is very important to maintain its quality. Handle the fish like it's your baby, he said. After all, your money comes from this fish. He told me that if I followed all these points, the fish market should give me the top grade for my fish. Well, there were so many things the extension officer had told me. But I thought to myself, you know, these things don't look so hard to do. And if it makes the fish market to buy my fish, then, man, I'm going to do it. I checked my ice slurry every so often to make sure it wasn't melting too fast. When the ice was getting a bit low, I decided to head back to shore. I was more than a bit nervous when I brought my boat into the fish market again. I had done all the things that the extension officer had told me, but I sure didn't know how this fish market supervisor would react. I had been out fishing for hours, and I was afraid that he might not take my fish again. I was so worried that I didn't even hear him come up.
Hey, we got plenty good fish for you now this time, huh?
I'd gone to the fisheries department like he told me, and I listened to everything the extension officer said. I'd packed all my fish in an ice slurry and had been very careful with handling them. And I gutted and gilled them just like he told me. The market supervisor looked at my fish very carefully before he finally looked up. At last, I feel like a fisherman again.